Well, hello and welcome to this DVD, or you might be watching online, to our 11th Sunday at Three service that we've done in this particular format. It's a bit like Songs of Praise, so we have a number of hymns, and today our vicar from St James's by the Park, Dan, is going to share a word with us for this Easter spectacular. My name's Esther, and I work as an Anna chaplain, supporting older people or resourcing older people spiritually in the city. And it's a great delight to be with you again. We've got a theme of Isaac Watts. He's a son of Southampton, was part of King Edward's school, and is obviously a really famous hymn writer who's been part of our city heritage. So we've got a couple of his hymns and a chance to hear a little bit more about him during this service. But of course, we are celebrating Easter. So I've got my Easter eggs ready. I hope you've got some too, to enjoy over the next few days, and to really celebrate the joy of the resurrection, of that life of Jesus, which he died and rose again in order that we might have life to the full. And Dan's going to talk a little bit more about the peace that we can have as we get to know Jesus in our Christian walk. So sit back and enjoy this time together, whatever time of day it is for you as you're watching. If you're watching at home alone, that's great and welcome. And if you're a care worker or a resident in one of the care homes that we support, also welcome. It's really great to have you participating with us today in this strange world where we're unable to physically meet together. But welcome.
I've popped down to the centre of town to stand in front of the statue of the most amazing Isaac Watts. Some of you will know him very well and his works. He was described as the father of English hymnology. He wrote over 750 hymns in his lifetime. He went to King Edward's school, so he was a real child of Southampton, and we have this wonderful, wonderful statue of him here, even if the pigeons don't show him much respect. And I just wanted to come down here to introduce the first hymn that we're going to sing together. You can sing the words that we're on recorded on the video here, of When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, an amazing hymn describing the death of Jesus on the cross at Easter, which is what we're celebrating. But it just gives us a chance to remember how that death has brought us new life, and that as his sorrow and blood flowed mingled down, we can have new life in him. So let's sing this hymn together, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Thank you.
Wonderful. What a fantastic hymn by an amazing poet and hymnologist, I think, written from Southampton. So when I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, Isaac Watts really had a sense of the glory of Jesus on that cross and the fantastic joy that we can see in the resurrection. When he says, when were the whole realm of nature mind, that were an offering far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. There's nothing that we can do that gives God more pleasure than to give our lives in service of him. So as we celebrate the delight of Easter, of that hope and that resurrection, it's just wonderful to remember together what it is that Jesus has done for us. I'm in Easter celebration. You can see I've got my palm crosses from last week and I've got my Easter eggs. I hope you've been able to find some Easter eggs. Now, Isaac Watts was a man who was really passionate about trying to encourage children to take responsibility or to be able to learn about Jesus for themselves. And he wrote a number of books and a number of verses to engage with children. He was a commensurate poet. And even when he was punished for his poetry, he continued to write and to speak out his words of poetry. There's a story saying that when he was asked why he was not praying with his eyes closed, he responded with the words, "A little mouse, for want of stairs, ran up a rope to say its prayers." And he was beaten for his poetry and his insubordination. And as he was being beaten, he said in also in verse, "O Father, Father, pity take, and I no more will verses make." But fortunately, he didn't stick to that promise and he continued to write poems and incredible hymns and verses for children to encourage them particularly. He was a nonconformist, so he was unable to attend Oxford and Cambridge universities, and his father was incarcerated a number of times for his nonconformist views, his way of managing church, which didn't fit with the Church of England at the time. It's astonishing to think that not so long ago, that was the state in the 1700s. But his love of children and a desire to communicate with them really resonated with me. And this next song that we're going to listen to together has been put together by the children in our church. So we've got a fantastic youth group. And Abigail and Josh and team have put together this rendition of a song which we sing, which is "Nothing is too big and nothing is too small for God." Just to remind us that if you're feeling insignificant or unimportant to God at the moment, that's not the case. We are all significant to him. We're all precious to him. And this song communicates that to us.
Nothing's too big, big, big for his power. Nothing's too little, little for his care. Nothing's too big, big, big for his power. Nothing's too little, little for his care. Nothing's too big, big, big for his power. Nothing's too wincy, wincy for his care. Nothing's too big, big, big for his power. Nothing's too teeny, weeny for his care. He is God of the big, God of the little, God of the stuff, somewhere in the middle. He's the king of moving mountains, loves you more than you will ever know. Oh, oh. Nothing's too big, big, big for his power. Nothing's too little, little for his care. Nothing's too big, big, big for his power. Nothing's too little, little for his care. Nothing's too big, big, big for his power. Nothing's too wincy, wincy for his care. Nothing's too big, big, big for his power. Nothing's too teeny, weeny for his care. He is God of the big, God of the little, God of the stuff, somewhere in for. Nothing's too much he cares for at all. Nothing's too big, nothing's too small. Nothing's too much he cares for at all. Nothing's too big, nothing's too small. Nothing's too much he cares for at all. Nothing's too big, nothing's too small. Nothing's too much he cares for at all. He is God of the big, God of the little, God of the stuff. Somewhere in the middle, he's the king of moving mountains. Loves you more than you will ever know. Whoa, nothing's too big.
Lovely. I hope that brought a song to your face and a smile even to your face, that song, and you were able to really enjoy joining in together. We're now going to enjoy listening to the reading, which is brought to us by Lena, who's our associate minister here at St James's by the Park. She's reading from John's Gospel, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. The story of the resurrection and of Thomas's experience. So thank you, Lena.
Hello. The reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and have yet believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name.
Hi there. It's good to be able to join with you, even in this virtual way, and to be able to share something of an Easter message. Because Easter brings hope for the hurting. The cross speaks to God entering in our world of deepest pain and in the darkest places, that he's personally invested in doing something about the pain and the darkness, that God has a love for us beyond our wildest imagination. And the resurrection speaks that when all hope seems lost, God finds a way out. Never write him off. And so I want to invite you to come with me in your imagination to that first Easter Sunday evening. Here's the scene. 10 of Jesus' friends are in lockdown. They're behind closed doors, fearful of what's going to happen. You see, they'd seen their friend and hero brutally murdered just a few days before. In fact, within the space of 24 hours, he'd been arrested and tried and convicted and executed and buried. It all happened with such breathtaking speed. They'd seen Judas, the one who'd been part of their gang. He'd betrayed Jesus. And so they've got a very real and palpable fear that the Jewish leaders who plotted Jesus' downfall are going to plot their downfall next. Fear is so real in that room that you could almost reach out and touch it. Fear. I wonder what you're afraid of at the moment. Many people, of course, are afraid of catching COVID. Many people are afraid of going out and walking the streets or going into a shop for fear of coming too close to other people. Some people are afraid of dying. Maybe you've got other very real non-pandemic fears at the moment, health fears unrelated to COVID, or fear about whether you're going to have a job in 6 months, or fear about making ends meet, or fear about your closest relationships or your loved ones, fear of missing out on yet more precious months of life while life seems to be put on hold. You see, fear was a massive issue for Jesus' friends in lockdown, and fear is a massive issue for so many of us today. And here's what the eyewitness accounts of that first Easter Sunday evening record. They say that on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." You see, in the midst of their fear, Jesus wanted to bring them peace. And in the midst of our fear, Jesus wants to bring you and me peace. Now, what do we mean by peace? It's not some sort of platitude that Jesus offers, as if it's some like, you know, there, it'll be all right, don't you got nothing to worry about really. No, Jesus never papers over the cracks or ducks the issues. And he's talking about a real, experienced peace. Peace which slows a galloping heart rate right down. Psychologists talk about the flight or fight response to fear. And sometimes we dream of flight, getting away from it all, as though peace is, you know, sort of lying on a beach or sitting in a favourite spot with a soothing music playing in our ears and a favourite drink in our hand and the birds cheeping away. We think of that as peace. But that's a flight response to fear. But Jesus isn't recommending that the disciples get away from it all and go and sit by the Med for a few days. And nor is he recommending the sort of the fight response. The fight response would say, look, get your swords ready, and if the Jewish leaders come and attack you, then you go get them first. Set an ambush for them. No, Jesus isn't saying that the way to get peace is to eliminate the threat. In fact, Jesus isn't talking about an external peace, peaceful circumstances around us, but he's talking about an internal peace, peace of heart. A peace which encamps in your heart even whilst the threat all around is still very real and present. You see, for the disciples, the doors are still locked, the threat is still real, but the peace which Jesus brings trumps their fear. Have you experienced that deep peace in the midst of turmoil? Peace which overwhelms whatever fears are lurking in our hearts. I think of the NHS worker who told me about the peace they felt despite being on the front line in the very midst of the pandemic, exposing themselves to very real risk day by day. Or I think of the woman who told me about the peace she felt as her husband lay dying. Or I think of someone who has been laid in bed for weeks with COVID, telling me about the peace they felt. Or I think of the person who said that just they regularly feel overwhelmed with all the responsibilities they've got and all the people there are to look out for and care for. But they said that if they stop and pray in the morning, then they feel peace and they're able to cope with the day. One of the very first followers of Jesus talked about a peace that surpasses all understanding. You know, a peace that makes no sense. And he was in prison when he wrote that. He had every reason to be fearful for his life and his well-being. But he knew that peace deep inside. You see, look at the outward situation and it makes no sense at all. but look at his heart. And that's where the peace is that Jesus offers to me and to you. So how do we experience this peace? The eyewitness who was in the room when this happened notes this. He said, Jesus showed them his hands and his side. In other words, he let them see the scars of his crucifixion. It was the Jesus who had been nailed to the cross and had the spear thrust in his side, who had triumphed over death. He was the risen, crucified one. The one who'd experienced terror at the thought of being executed. The one who really does get what fear feels like, but the one who'd come out on the other side. And you see, contemplating both the weakness and the glory of Jesus is part of the way to experience his peace. Now, maybe you think this is all a bit fanciful. After all, dead men don't rise, do they? And living people don't walk through locked doors. Surely this was a ghost they were seeing, just a figment of their fear-filled, grief-stricken imagination. And that's a really important question. I mean, if Jesus is still a dead person, he can't bring real peace, can he? He might be able to bring some sort of placebo effect of peace that adds a nice touch to life whenever we're, you know, whenever anything is going well. But a placebo effect isn't going to endure through life's most fearful situations. So did Jesus really rise from the dead? Was Jesus really capable of walking into locked rooms full of fear? Is Jesus really capable of walking into the room of our heart when it is locked and fearful? Or is it just imagination? Well, enter Thomas into this eyewitness account. You know, he'd been missing that first Easter Sunday evening. We don't know why. The other 10, of course, had told him excitedly that they'd seen Jesus. And he did what some of you doubtless do. He laughed at the ridiculous notion. Tom said, look, if I can't put my finger in his hands and my hand in his side, then I'm not going to believe. In other words, I don't want to see him just as a figment of my imagination. I've got to touch him. I've got to have hard physical proof that he's come back from the dead before I'm going to believe such an outrageous story. And inside he's thinking, and that's not going to happen in a million years. And yet just 1 week later, he got that very proof. Jesus came again, same room. Same locked doors, same real fear and threat, same Jesus, same crucifixion scars, same peace that he came to offer them all. And the eyewitness tells us that Jesus said, put your finger here, Tom, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. In other words, Jesus knew Tom's doubts and he spoke straight into them. He wasn't having a go at Tom, sort of castigating him for his refusal to believe. He was coming alongside Tom and gently saying, look, yes, I know it's hard to believe, but this really is me, the one who died for you. I really have triumphed over death. I really can bring peace and meaning and hope. I know that these last 10 days have been the worst nightmare of your life. But I want you to wake up out of that nightmare into a joy-filled present better than you could ever imagine. Stop doubting and believe. And that's exactly what Tom did. He stopped doubting and believed. Now, Jesus' resurrection isn't make-believe. You know, some of the finest minds out there agree that Jesus really did rise from the grave. And if he can conquer death, then I'm sure that walking into a locked room isn't too much trouble for him. And listen to what Tom said when Jesus challenged him to stop doubting and believe. He fell at Jesus' feet and he said, my Lord and my God. In other words, he instinctively recognised that this is no mere human that he is talking to. Someone who'd claimed to be God and proved that by doing lots of miracles. Someone who'd claimed to be the resurrection and the life and proved that by coming back from the dead. He couldn't now just think of him as a friend. Jesus was his Lord and his God. So if you want to receive the peace that only Jesus can give, not the flight or fight type of peace, but the peace that transcends and overwhelms fear, then behold him. Look at him, the crucified yet risen one. But also worship him as your Lord and God. It's quite natural to have doubts about who he is, but Jesus wants to say to you very gently, as he said to Tom, stop doubting, believe. Will you do that? But maybe you think, well, you know, it was okay for Tom and his friends. They got to see and touch Jesus in the flesh. I want that sort of proof too, you say. How am I supposed to get that? Well, Jesus has you in mind as well. He said to Tom, look, because you have seen me and you have believed, but blessed are those who haven't seen me and yet have believed. And so here's Jesus' promise to you. He says, you know, whether you take Jesus' resurrection on the historical evidence that points to Jesus' resurrection, or whether you take it on the word of me and others like me who testify to the reality of Jesus' presence in our lives, and whether you take this evidence sort of reluctantly or eagerly, you know, as soon as you take just that small step of faith, Jesus says, you're blessed. He loves it when people come to him as Lord and God. He longs to give you his blessing and his peace and so much more that we haven't got time to go into now. And John, the eyewitness who wrote down this account of the risen Jesus, the Jesus who gives hope to the hurting and peace to the fearful, he adds his own invitation. He was writing it down for our benefit so that you and I could have faith in Jesus. And here's what he wrote as a PS. He said, look, these things were written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So Jesus is offering me and you his blessing. And John has gone to the trouble of writing all this down for us so that we can stop doubting and believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing in him we may find true life. So will you join me in putting your trust in Jesus, the one who brings hope to the hurting? I don't know what fears you have at the moment. But whatever the fears and outward threats, Jesus wants to bring you his inner peace. The peace that confounds, the peace that makes no sense in the circumstances, but the peace that is very real, that overwhelms the fears in our hearts. So in the midst of whatever fears you have, will you focus on Jesus, the one who still has scars from the nails in his hands and the spear in his side, the one who died and rose again? And will you put your trust in him as your Messiah? Will you submit to him as your Lord? Will you worship him as your God? Will you receive the peace that he offers? There is hope for the hurting. There is peace for the fearful. Let me pray for you. Lord Jesus, thank you for the reality of your resurrection, your triumph over death, and thank you that you bring peace where we are fearful. Would you bring your peace now to all who are watching this? Would your peace overwhelm whatever fears are in those hearts? As you come into the locked door of their hearts, bring your peace. And I pray that you would bring your blessing, the blessing of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a very happy Easter.
Fantastic. Thank you, Dan, for your encouraging words and for that challenge to us to consider our own relationship with Jesus. And I wonder for some of you whether that's something that you haven't considered or you haven't considered in recent years. And I'd really encourage you to take some time to consider how you might want to respond to that. to that call. And our next song, which I'm going to introduce to you in front of my beautiful magnolia tree, just encourages you to think a little bit more so of what it means to follow Jesus.
Lovely. So I've come out to show you the splendour of my lovely magnolia tree. I showed you a picture of it last DVD, but this time it's in full blossom. So just as we're enjoying the beauty of Easter, I wanted to share the beauty of this lovely tree. And we're going to sing this next hymn, which has been chosen for you by Sue Baverstock, who's one of our regular watchers. It's called My Jesus, My Saviour.
Forever I'll love you, forever.
So Sue's a woman who has been really inspired by her faith. Her relationship with Jesus has given her a sense of peace, a sense of security, and a sense of courage during this lockdown. She's not been well, and she's really been able to draw on the strength that her relationship with Jesus has given her, which is why she was keen for us to sing that song, My Jesus, My Saviour. He's the one on whom she depends and on whom she's able to take her courage at this particular time. We're going to pray together now with Marjorie Crane, who is one of our stalwarts, usually makes cakes and supports us at Sunday at 3, as well as taking part in our services. So thank you to Marjorie as you lead us in prayer now.
Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for the beauty of your creation. As we see the blossom, the forsythia, the magnolia, along with the small but equally beautiful spring flowers, primroses, daffodils, the tulips bursting forth around us. There's a feeling of joy as we see the birds starting to collect material for their nests. After a difficult year of COVID, affecting all of us in some ways, we are now seeing plans for the restrictions to be eased gradually, leading us to a time when we can enjoy anew contacts with friends and families. We praise you, Lord, for the inspiration you have given to the experts who have designed and produced vaccines for our protection and for others around the world, especially that there is now a vaccine that can be used in countries lacking many of our facilities for vaccine storage, bringing potential relief to so many. We give thanks for the generosity of the huge number of volunteers who have helped with the rollout. Above all, with Christians around the world, we thank you, our loving Father, for the wonderful gift of love and hope you gave to the world that first Easter. As Isaac Watts put it, love so amazing, so divine, to give living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We pray especially, Father, for those who have found this year particularly difficult. We pray for all those who are grieving, those who have suffered or are still suffering from COVID-19, those who have lost jobs this year, and those who have found the social isolation very hard to bear. In a moment of quiet, you may wish to bring before our loving Father somebody you know who is suffering. Help them to find comfort and hope in the wonder of the Easter message. In the words of one of Paul's letters to the Romans, Romans 15, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us say together the words our Lord taught us to say, the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for your prayers for us, Marjorie. And thank you for the acknowledgement that Jesus is Lord and God knows us wherever we are. We're going to listen, potentially sing, if you're brave enough, to our final hymn, which has been chosen by Dan, the vicar who preached, and is also been written by Isaac Watts, which is why I'm here again outside his statues. We haven't got any pigeons at the moment. And the hymn that Dan has chosen is Jesus Shall Reign Where'er the Sun Does His Successive Journeys Run. And it talks about our endless prayers to Jesus, and also that amazing verse that says, people and realms of every tongue dwell in his love with sweetest song. And this Easter time, the unity that we can have together as Christians around the world brings an amazing, amazing blessing. And the last verse says, let every creature rise and bring its highest honours to our King. Angels descend with songs again, and earth repeat the loud Amen. Let's sing this together.
Find eternal
Well, what a wonderful rendition of that hymn by the Gettys. Really superb to be reminded that Jesus will reign wherever the sun shines, and to him endless prayers will be made, and every creature will rise and bring the highest honours to the King, and angels descend with song again, and earth repeat the loud Amen. I hope you've really enjoyed being with us together for this service and hearing something of the life of Isaac Watts, but also the incredible news of the resurrection of Jesus. And I would encourage you to, again, to consider where you stand with that. And if you want to know more, join us again and certainly log into other resources that are on the church's webpage. I just need to say thank you to the people who put together this service. So to Mark and Gordon and Tina, who did the technical stuff for us, thank you very much indeed. To Dan for taking time to really share your wisdom with us as we've looked at John's Gospel. And for Lena and Marjorie for your words of prayers and reading to us. And for Sue and Marjorie and Dan who've chosen hymns for us. We really thank you for that. Let's say together, shall we, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. So let's share the grace together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. If we were together, we would stop and have a cup of tea and some cake and a chance to really chat together. And we're sorry that we can't do that in the flesh at the moment, but we look forward to doing so. There are some occasional services happening in the church, and hopefully things will move towards having a possibility of getting together in the very near future. But in the meantime, stay safe and look after those you love and be in touch with them. Many thanks and goodbye.